What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Those that fail to learn from history are doomed to repeat it. This saying by Winston Churchill efficiently summarizes dynamic programming, and hopefully by the end of the video, you'll know why. You see, dynamic programming, or DP, is an algorithm technique used when solving an optimization problem. It breaks it down into simpler sub-problems and utilizes the fact that the optimal solution to the overall problem depends upon the optimal solution to its sub-problems. But isn't that exactly how we defined recursion in one of our previous videos? Well, yeah, and that's because DP is just an optimized version of recursion. Now, before we delve into dynamic programming, let's bring back one of the examples we gave in our recursion video. The code you see is the recursive implementation of the Fibonacci numbers we previously covered. Here, our main method is called twice, once to calculate the n-1 value and once to calculate the n-2 value. Therefore, the time complexity of the overall method is 2 to the power n. To visualize this complexity, take a look at the diagram representing the method calls in front of you. Notice how our method may be called multiple times for the same input. For example, to retrieve the Fibonacci of 5, we'll need to retrieve the Fibonacci of 4 and 3. However, to retrieve the Fibonacci of 4, we'll need to recalculate again the Fibonacci of 3, even though we just calculated it. And this gets even worse, so as the number we are trying to pass to the method becomes bigger, the number of repeated calls will tremendously increase. One way to make this algorithm faster and optimize our current method is to remember our history, our past. It's to remember the previously calculated values so that the Fibonacci for any given number is calculated only once. The simplest way to do that is to create an array and store inside this array the intermediate values needed to calculate the targeted Fibonacci, as you can see in the code snippet in front of you. The time complexity of this method is linear, or O of n, since we only have one for loop that runs till n. Okay, before proceeding further, let's lay down why this approach, YDP, is better than recursion. First, recursion is not really efficient in terms of memory, as it is always limited by the stack space in the system. If a recursive function requires more memory than what is available in the call stack, a common and prevalent error called stack overflow occurs. Additionally, it is not fast. Iterating over an array by making use of loops is faster than recursion because every time a method is called, there is an overhead of allocating space for that method and all its data in the call stack. This causes a slight delay in recursive methods when compared to iteration. In recursion, the same method can be called multiple times with the same arguments. In other words, the same result is calculated multiple times instead of just once. In dynamic programming, a recursive method is optimized by storing the intermediate results in a data structure. With that said, you should know that DP mainly provides two approaches to solve a recursive problem, tabulation and memoization. Let's break them down. Tabulation, or the bottom-up approach, is actually what we wrote a couple minutes ago. It is implemented with iteration and starts at the base cases. So our journey starts from the building blocks and continues by accumulating our intermediate answers all the way to the top to our final answer. In our Fibonacci example, we stored the results of each method call in an array, and whenever an already stored value is needed, we fetch the value from the array instead of computing it repeatedly. Here we can do even better and save space, so instead of using an array, we can use two variables since we only require the nth term in each iteration. Most of the time when you use tabulation, you'll be able to do the same and optimize space further, and we'll discuss how to approach these problems in the upcoming videos of this series. Concerning memoization, or the top-down approach, it is implemented with recursion and made efficient by keeping track of the previously calculated results in a data structure. You see, memoizing a result means storing the result of a method call, usually in a hash map or an array, so that when the same method is invoked again, we can simply return the memoized result instead of recalculating the same value. So, here our journey starts from the topmost destination state, and we compute its answers by taking into account the values of states that can reach the destination state, till we reach the bottommost base state, just like recursion. In our Fibonacci example, what we need to do is create a map and add a condition to our recursive call. So, if this map contains the result we are trying to calculate, then just return it. If not, we calculate this result and store it inside the map, making it available for all recursive calls. To sum up, in memoization, we start by finding the Fibonacci of n and then go back and try to calculate n-1 and n-2. However, in tabulation, we started with Fibonacci of 0 and 1 and built our way to the top to the value of n, hence the bottom-up and top-down names given to them. Now, which approach is better? You see, the bottom-up implementation's runtime is usually faster, as iteration does not have the overhead that recursion does. However, the top-down implementation is usually much easier to write. This is because with recursion, the ordering of sub-problems does not matter, whereas with tabulation, we need to go through a logical ordering of solving the sub-problems. Okay, the last question I'll try to answer in this video is when to use dynamic programming. You see, we previously identified a DP problem as a problem that can be broken down into overlapping sub-problems or as a problem that has an optimal sub-structure. But how do we detect such problems? The first characteristic that is common in DP problems is that the problem will ask for the optimum value, maximum or minimum of something, or the number of ways there are to do something. For example, what is the minimum cost of doing something? Or what is the maximum profit from? Or how many ways there are to do this or that? Or what is the longest possible? Etc. Keep in mind that not all DP problems follow this format, and not all problems that follow these formats should be solved using DP. However, these formats are very common for DP problems and are generally a hint that you should consider using dynamic programming. The second characteristic that is common in DP problems is that future decisions depend on earlier decisions. Deciding to do something at one step may affect the ability to do something in a later step. This is what makes a greedy algorithm invalid for a DP problem, as we need to factor in results from previous decisions or calculations. This characteristic is not as well defined as the first one, and the best way to identify it is to go through some examples. And that is exactly what we'll be doing in the upcoming videos of this series. So to sum up, dynamic programming is an exceptional variant of recursion that compensates for its drawbacks. However, DP can sometimes be hard to grasp and identify, making it a popular candidate for coding interviews. And whether you're a student preparing for a job or a professional, understanding how dynamic programming works can immensely benefit you. Please let us know which DP problems you'd like us to tackle next in the comments. And until then, I hope this was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.